Good morning, church family. We are so excited to be back with you this week. We just thank each one of you who watched the service online last week. We're so grateful for that. And just our prayer for you guys through all this is that even though you're not here and we're not here together, we just pray that He speaks to you through this time. And then He speaks through you through something that we might sing or something that is said. So we're just so grateful to be here this morning. So wherever you are, wherever you're watching this, we just encourage you just to worship. If you are in your living room, stand up and get ready just to sing and clap your hands as we start this morning. And we are so happy that you've chosen to worship with us today. Count on one thing, the same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. Yes, I will lift you high.
good. You turn it for good. You take the enemy memory and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. You take the enemy memory and you turn it for good.
Tremble. higher than any other name. At the name of Jesus, everything must bow. We just take a little time this morning to declare the name of Jesus. We declare the name of Jesus over every situation. We declare the name of Jesus over this nation. We declare the name of Jesus over this world. We declare the name of Jesus into these homes. We declare the name of Jesus over that marriage. We declare the name of Jesus over that job. We declare the name of Jesus over this crisis. We know you are bigger, God. You are bigger, God. You've not been caught by surprise. You've not been caught with your guard down, no. Jesus, Jesus, you still make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus, you still silence every fear. Oh, Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus, oh.
This morning, wherever you're watching, just lift your hands wherever you're at and sing it this morning. Sing Jesus.
Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus, you silence fear. Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus,
I worship.
gotten that this morning. He's the way maker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. Father God, we just thank you so much for those words, Lord, that we find in this song this morning. Lord, just in the middle of just everything that is going on around us, Lord, we thank you that you are making ways for us. God, and we just thank you that, Lord, this situation that our world is in, Father, it did not take you by surprise. Lord, you were not caught off guard. And we just thank you for that. And we thank you for our trust that we can put in you. Lord, we thank you that when we lay down at night, when we get up in the morning, when we start our day, when we're going through our day, God, when we're having lunch, God, whatever we're doing, we know that you are in control. God, and that you are guiding our steps, you're guiding our path, and we just thank you so much for that this morning. Lord, I just thank you for everybody who is watching online this morning. I pray that, Lord, you just bless them this morning, God, and you keep them. Lord, and once again, we just say, as one today, we love you. God, we love you. And we thank you for all that, Lord, you are going to turn for good in this situation. Lord, all the stories that we have yet to hear about how you brought good into this bad situation. Only you can do that. Only you can do that. Lord, we just say once again, we love you. We thank you for today. And we pray these things this morning in your name. And everybody said amen.
Good morning, everybody. I want to welcome you in that are being with us here today. This is the day that the Lord has made, and I will rejoice and be glad in it today. He's given us another wonderful, beautiful day. And I just want to come to you today in the name of Jesus. And it's my heart's desire really to be able to speak some things into your lives and into our lives concerning what's going on and what we're facing today. And so I do want to tell you, I want to start out by saying we sure do miss everybody. I miss all the little ones running around. What a blessing you are. And I just want to tell you, I miss you. We miss each and every one. We're missing the young adults, the youth, everyone. You're so special. I thank God for you. I want to know that we're praying for you, and I know that you're praying too. You know, as we pray, I believe someone else is praying for us, because we're planting a seed of faith, and we're planting a faith prayer. And the Bible says, for whatsoever we sow, we will reap. So I just believe as we pray, someone else is praying for us as well. And I just want to welcome everybody in. No matter where you go to church, we thank you for viewing in right now. You know, it's very obvious we're in different times. But thank God that we have someone that we can trust in. So I want to go ahead and tell you where we're going to start this morning. If you want to take your Bible, and I encourage you to do that. Turn with me to Matthew chapter 14, and we're going to begin in verse 22, and I've got several scriptures that I want us to look at. And before I jump into that, I know this is a little different here. Some of you may be thinking, well, Brother Morris, why aren't you standing up? Well, I just thought I'd kind of lay back and do it this way this morning. We need to be informed, as I said before, about what's going on, but at the same time, we need to be able to rest in God and know that He's got this thing and that He's got us. And so I just wanted to come to you a little bit different this morning. And also I want to make mention of this. You know, we don't know for sure how long this is going to go on, so we're going to try to continue to come to you in ways like this. I will tell you, for some of you that are wondering, well, what's going on? Should we allow the government to dictate what we do and don't do? In this case, brothers and sisters, I think that we should comply with them because of their motive. This is not some type of Christian persecution. This is not the way that I look at this. This is a war. It's a battle that's going on. And we should be willing to contribute and to do our part and to help stop this. So I totally agree with the social distancing that they're doing, and I think I understand where they're coming from with this. So we want to do the right thing and get this thing stopped as soon as possible so we can get back to the way things used to be. And I do believe that things are going to return back. I know I've heard some, and you've heard it too. Everybody's listening to the media right now. Some of them saying this is going to be the new normal. It may change things in some ways, but this is not the first time something has happened. So it's unfortunate that it's happened, but I do think that things are going to get back to pretty much the way that they were. We're definitely going to be more germ cautious. That is for sure. So I'm going to leave all that to the experts. I just want us to get into God's Word right now, and it's my intent to help bring you comfort and speak something into your lives that can help us, because we're all faced with the same thing right now. I think that we're all feeling this roller coaster of emotions, and no one is exempt from it. And there's several scripture here that I just want to read and kind of just lay it out here for us, and then I'm going to come back and make a few comments about this scripture. But I believe it's going to speak directly into our lives right now. And so as you're going to see as I read this, you're going to see that it actually has a lot in common, and it's speaking about rain and waves and storms and getting out on the water. And we see this in the Gospels. And as we look at it, we can relate this to our lives right now, I believe, in a very similar way. So I'm in Matthew chapter 14, and I'm going to begin reading in verse 22. And the Bible says, "And straightway Jesus constrained his disciples to get into a ship and to go before him unto the other side, while he sent the multitudes away. And when he had sent the multitudes away, he went up into a mountain apart to pray. And when the evening was come, he was there alone. But the ship was now in the midst of the sea, tossed with the waves, for the wind was contrary. And in the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went unto them, walking on the sea. And when his disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were troubled, saying, It is a spirit. And they cried out for fear. But straightway Jesus spake unto them, saying, Be of good cheer. It is I, be not afraid. And Peter answered him and said, Lord, if it be thou, bid me to come to thee on the water. And he said, come. And when Peter was come down out of the ship, he walked on the water to go to Jesus. But when he saw the wind boisterous, he was afraid, and beginning to sink, he cried, saying, Lord, save me. And immediately Jesus stretched forth his hand and caught him, and said unto him, O thou little faith, wherefore didst thou doubt? And when they were coming to the ship, the wind ceased. Then they that were in the ship came and worshipped him, saying, of a truth, thou art the Son of God. Hallelujah. What a wonderful story. So just let that soak in and hang on to that. And now let's go to Mark chapter 4. And we're going to read another instance here that's going to be very similar. And beginning in, I believe it's verse 35. And the same day when the evening was come, he said unto them, let us pass over to the other side. And when they had sent away the multitude, they took him even as he was in the ship. And there were also with him other little ships. And there arose a great storm of wind, and the waves beat into the ship, so that it was now full. And he was in the hinder part of the ship, asleep on a pillow. And they awake him and say unto him, Master, carest thou not that we perish? And he arose and rebuked the wind and said unto the sea, peace, be still. And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. And he said unto them, why are you so fearful? How is it that you have no faith? And they feared exceedingly and said one to another, what manner of man is this, that even the wind and the sea obey him? Glory to God. Isn't that wonderful? Well, let's just keep on going. And I want to take you now to Luke chapter 8. And we'll begin, I believe it's somewhere around verse 22. Look with me here. Now it came to pass on a certain day that he went into a ship with his disciples, and he said unto them, let us go over unto the other side of the lake. And they launched forth. But as they sailed, he fell asleep. And there came down a storm of wind on the lake, and they were filled with water and were in jeopardy. And they came to him and awoke him, saying, Master, Master, we perish. Then he rose and rebuked the wind and the raging of the water, and they ceased, and there was a calm. And he said unto them, where is your faith? And they, being afraid, wondered, saying one to another, what manner of man is this? For he commandeth even the winds and the water, and they obey him. Hallelujah. What a mighty God we serve. Just think about these things, if you will, and just let it soak in. And I have one more place that I'd like for us to turn to at this point. And this is Matthew chapter 7. And I'm going to begin reading in verse 24. And this is going to be so familiar to you, but I believe it's going to minister to us. Therefore, whosoever heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them, I will liken him unto a wise man, which built his house upon a rock. And the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew, and beat upon that house, and it fell not, for it was founded upon a rock. And every one that heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them not, shall be likened unto a foolish man, which built his house upon the sand. And the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew, and beat upon that house, and it fell, and great was the fall of it. And it came to pass, when Jesus had ended these sayings, The people were astonished at his doctrine, for he taught them as one having authority and not as the scribes. Would you join me in prayer right now? Dear Heavenly Father, I just want to thank you for the Word of God. I want to thank you for the truth. I want to thank you, Lord, for the comfort. I want to thank you for the peace, for the instruction, for all that we can glean from your Word. Lord, I want to thank you that faith cometh by hearing, hearing by the Word of God. And Lord, I just want to thank you that what you've done before, you'll do again. Lord, I just want to thank you that, Lord, there's nothing new to you under the sun, and that you're not taken by surprise by anything. Lord, I give you praise, and I give you honor, and I give you glory. And Lord, I don't claim to know everything that this teaches, but God, I know the one that wrote it. And Lord, I thank you and I praise you. And Father, I thank you for your great salvation. And Lord, I thank you for coming into this world and laying down your life and being willing to die a sinner's death. And on the third day, being rose again. Hallelujah. God, I give you praise. Whew. Lord, I thank you. I thank you for that cross. And I thank you, Lord, that what you did on that cross that one time, Lord, it's changed everything. And I give you glory, and I give you praise for it right now. Bless each and every one, Lord, that's out there. All of those that are hurting right now, we just remember them. And Father, I just ask you to rebuke this devourer. God, you are able, as you did all this wind rebuking, and Lord, and just putting nature back in its place. But Father, also I ask you that, Lord, help us to allow these times and these things to speak to us in the ways that we need to be spoken to right now, each and every one of us, no matter where we are. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Well, I've got just a few comments that I want to make, and ain't he wonderful? He's so good. And I just want to tell you, he knows what you're feeling right now. We have not a high priest who cannot be touched by our feelings. He knows exactly what we're going through. And as we've read these different parts of Scripture, we see the likeness and the similarity in so many of these. And I want to point out one thing to you as I go through my little list of comments that I couldn't help but notice that really sticks out to me. And it didn't come out of this last scripture that I read, but out of the others. Did you notice that Jesus is a really good sleeper? It's amazing how well that Jesus could sleep on a ship or a boat right in the middle of troublesome times. Well, of course, we know that he was God. He was fully God. But you know what? He was probably worn out too, because Jesus went about doing good and healing all of those who were sick and afflicted by the devil. And he was doing good things, ministering unto the needs of people. And physically, he would just be worn out. But I just thought that was pretty neat, that usually when they got on a ship, Jesus went to sleep. But you know, the Bible teaches us that God never sleeps and he never slumbers. There's never a time when he's unaware of what's going on in our lives. And I want to tell you right now where you are. He knows what you're experiencing. And he's there with you. He is there. And he's going to provide for you. And I believe that he's going to speak into our hearts if we'll allow him and say, peace be still. The second thing that I noticed that really stood out to me is that if you just sort of look at this at face value, it seems that they had bad timing when it came to getting into ships and going out on the water. Well, we know that God's timing is perfect. But isn't it amazing that usually when Jesus told them, like, we're going to go across to the other side, there was always going to be some challenges. And brothers and sisters, we're in a challenge right now. He's told us that he that hath begun a good work in you shall complete it until the day of Jesus Christ. He's also told us to let not your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not true, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. I want to tell you, God finishes what he starts. And he's not left us. He is with us. He is a very, very present help in trouble. And he's with us in the midst of this storm that we're going through. Obviously, the disciples were taught many life lessons through these times. But I want to tell you that just because Jesus sent them across, it doesn't mean that he created the storm on purpose. Storms in life come naturally. And I believe that the storms that we face, and let's just sort of put this in a spiritual perspective, are as many, many times are as a result of the fall of man. And so it can be traced back to the original sin, but God uses these things to get our attention. And I believe that he's speaking today. Are we listening? I just want to speak to someone right now. Maybe that you've realized, things are kind of wrecked. We can't even go to church. Maybe there's someone that's realizing, man, I've took things for granted. And I just want to tell you today, if that's what you're getting out of this, maybe you're in a place of being backslidden. I heard Adrian Rogers say one time that if there's ever been a time that we were closer to God than what we are right now, we're backslidden. I want to encourage you, dear friend, reach out to me. He'll, if your wood is wet, my God can light wet wood. Hallelujah. Whew. Glory to God. He loves you. And I just believe he's reaching out and speaking to all of us in whatever way that we need to hear from him right now. I want to tell you, there's a lot of humbling going on right now. I believe people are praying like never before, feeling a sense of really of humility and smallness, because we're realizing we're not in control. None of us are, but there's one that is. Hallelujah. He's in control and he's going to take care of us. He promised that he would. So these things come in life, and these storms, and this is a battle. And it's a storm, and it's raging. But God is with us, and he's going to help us get through it. And then the third thing that I wanted to point out after reading these things, the fear would come upon Jesus' disciples. And they were like, why is he sleeping? Does he not care about us? And they would become fearful. And Jesus would address that. But I want to tell you, God understands. And I want to tell you, I don't believe that there's anybody that's not somewhat a little bit fearful. It's natural for us, but thank God for faith, hope, and love, like I talked about last week. And for us to understand that we're perfectly loved by God, and that complete, perfect love gives us the ability to cast off that fear. So thank God for that. And just reach out and do that right now in the name of Jesus. And I believe that he's saying, peace, be still. But the third thing that I want to mention is it was never as bad as his disciples thought. Now hang with me right there. I'm not making light of how bad it is. This coronavirus, it's a bad thing. And one of the things that makes it so bad is its ability to spread so quickly. But when you look at these stories in the Bible and you see the viruses that they were facing, so to speak, you know, they weren't viruses, but they were storms of life, difficulties that they were going through. Usually, it wasn't as bad as they thought it was going to be. And they just needed a little reminder of who was in control. And brothers and sisters, that's what God gave them. And I believe that that's what God is going to give you and I want to tell you today that the master of the sea rose up and he rebuked the winds and the waves. And he said, peace, be still. And I believe today that we'll call upon him and ask him in humbleness and repentance, a true repentant heart, and admit to him our failures and our shortcomings. I believe that he'll rebuke the wind and the waves and say, peace, be still. And I believe that right now where you are, that he can speak into our hearts, speak into our lives, and say, peace, be still. Remember in John 16, he said, my peace I leave unto you. Be of good cheer, I have overcome the world. In this world you will have trouble, trials and tribulations, but be of good cheer, for I have overcome the world. And then, lastly, I want to point out to you the last scripture that we looked at, which was somewhat different. So, in closing, can you believe that? Actually, here in closing, in Matthew 7, so I read the story that Jesus told about the man that built his house on the rock. And then he gives us an example of someone who built their house on sinking sand. Brothers and sisters, you and I have built our lives. Jesus said, upon this rock I shall build my church. And he is building us. But our lives is built upon the solidness and the firmness and the sureness of God himself and upon Jesus, his son. Hallelujah. And I want you to take courage from that right now, because you've got a firm foundation to stand on. And though these times are hard and they're tough and they're different, you know, in this story, the winds came, the rain came and beat, and the waves, but it was unable to blow the house or the life off of that great, solid foundation. Hallelujah. You know, with God, you know, we can bend in times like this, but we're not going to break. Hallelujah. Now, that wasn't true about the other illustration of the person that was built on the sinking sand. Not a good foundation. Anybody that's a builder or a contractor out there, you know that you can't build anything unless you have a good, solid, firm foundation You've got to have that. That's of utmost importance. And I want to tell you today, right there where you are, if you don't have that, then what you're experiencing can be devastating for you. What's going on in the world can be overcoming to you right now if you don't have that. And I want to say this to you. I do believe that this is part of the shaking that's going on in our world. I'm sure that there's others that are talking about that. But there's a shaking happening right now. And just in a natural sense, if you can think with me, whenever something is jostled, it reveals what's on the inside. My friend, I want to speak to someone right now that maybe through this time it's being revealed to you that maybe you've just been playing with God or playing church or playing Christianity. I want to tell you, God knows about all of that. But going through what we're going through in this shaking right now, if you think that that's you, if you think, you know, I'm not, and there's a sense where none of us are what we ought to be, thank God for His grace. I'll be the first to admit that, but if you've come to realize that maybe, you know, in other words, have you just been taking God for granted, continuing to live in sin and do your own thing, but now you're realizing, wait a minute, this is where I'm at. I want to encourage you right now, call upon Him. He's rich. He said, he that would come unto me, in no wise will I turn him away. He would never turn you away. And I believe right now that there's people that are calling upon him and turning to him. We can't go to church right now. I believe that as a result of these times, when the church doors get opened back up, I believe some of you out there, you're saying, buddy, I'm going to be there. And I'm going to serve him. And that's what he wants. He wants your heart. He wants my heart. He wants us to live for him. He wants us to know him, as Paul said, that I might know him and the power of his resurrection and fellowship of his suffering, being made conformable unto his death, and then ultimately experiencing the resurrection. And I want to tell you, dear friend, that there's resurrection power for you to claim and to live by right now. Would you just bow your heads with me right there where you are? And if this is someone that I'm talking about, if this is you, would you just call out to him right now and just tell him, Lord, I've blown it. And, you know, I've been playing around. I need you so desperately in my life. And this has caused me to wake up. I'm waking up right now, and I'm repenting of my sin. I'm changing my mind. It's going to change the way I live. I'm going to begin to follow you. Dear friend, if you prayed that prayer, I encourage you to call me. I won't even give you my cell phone number. 256-996-0942. Call me. And let me know. There's angels that are rejoicing in heaven right now. Glory to God. Hallelujah. I just want you to understand that these times, this shaking, it will reveal where we truly are in our heart. Amen. And God wants us all. And dear friend, brothers and sisters, I just want to encourage you. I want to tell you what a great foundation you have. And God is with you, and He's with us. And I truly believe, He said, can you hear me now? Verizon wasn't the first one that said that. And I believe that we're hearing Him. So trust Him. He's got us. And I pray to God right now that He speak to your heart and say, wind and waves, peace, shh, be still. In the name of Jesus, hallelujah. Well, thank you for tuning in, and we'll be back with you soon. And once again, if you prayed a prayer of repentance or rededication, or just asked Jesus to come in and you become a Christian, born again believer, give me a call. I'd love to hear from you. And I've got a little song I'm going to try to do for you now, so bear with me. I'm going to jump up here just for a quick moment.
God bless you, brothers and sisters. We'll see you next time. Stay safe. Peace. Be still. In Jesus' name. See you.